There are multiple types of documentation for an API. The most popular one is the reference guide. For example, on the left, I have a Java doc API, which basically, this is the Oxygen Java API, which lists all the classes that are exposed by Oxygen. And if you click on one of the classes, it lists all the methods and their explanation. On the right-hand side, there is a REST API for our Content Fusion product, which basically lists the HTTP endpoints that an application can connect to. For example, the expanded one is an API that allows one to change the settings for a review task. But some people think that API documentation is only this part, only the Java doc or the REST API reference guide, because these are the simplest ways to, these are the simplest to generate. Usually people generate them from source code. The content is written by developers in the form of code comments, and the quality is not very good usually, but at least it is something. But a good documentation, besides a reference guide, it also needs a topical guide. I like to compare this with Lego. So a reference guide would be a list of all the pieces, of all the blocks that are included in the box. But if you want to build a helicopter, it's not very useful to see that you have 200 building blocks. So you also need to have a topical guide that teaches you how to assemble the various parts of the helicopter. And in such a topical guide, you would usually present some general context, concepts, and usually you have to tune it for the intended audience. So if you expect that your users already know a particular programming language, or if you expect them to, in case of Oxygen, if I expect the user to be a CMS that wants to integrate the web author, I'm writing the content in a way, and if I'm expecting that there is a spell checker that wants to integrate with web author, I write a topic in a different way. So there are various use cases, and the user guide should be written on based on the user profile and on the use case that the user wants to achieve. A common structure for a topical guide is to first present an API overview that basically let the people know what the API is good for. For example, if the API is good to integrate web author in a CMS. So sometimes people are just trying to decide on a technology, and they read like 10 documentations, and they want to see at a glance whether the technology is good for them. And in such an overview, you could highlight the things that the API is good for. For example, the Google Maps API is good for embedding in an event page if you want to make sure that people... can you help her? For example, you can embed a map in the event page to make sure that all the people come at the right location. Another section is the getting started section, which helps people create a minimal working application that uses your API. This is the equivalent of the Hello World snippet in all programming languages. Then you could also include some general technical details, like how is the this section is more applicable for REST APIs. So how is the authentication and authorization supposed to work, whether it uses API tokens or OAuth or something like this? How error codes are, what is the meaning of the error codes? Whether the API has a rate limiting, whether you can make thousands of requests per second, or you should consider caching or something to reduce your request rate to a lower limit. Another section may be an API quick reference, like listing the main endpoints of the API with a short description of what they are used for. A glossary that contains the concepts. For example, in GitHub, there is the concept of a software repository, the concept of a user, there is the concept of a file, and a repository can have multiple branches, and the relation between them. This is good for a developer to create the big picture of how your service is designed. And you can also include some API best practices that guide users. So sometimes you can have some deprecated APIs, or over time you have implemented better ways to achieve certain use cases, and this is the place to include those. Another part of the documentation for an API is the user manual. If the API is for an end user product like Oxygen, maybe the developer also needs to understand several concepts that are in the user manual. For example, they might need to understand what a transformation scenario is, what is a project in Oxygen, or things like this. So in order for a developer to use the API, they need to read and to understand several guides, like the user guide, the topical guide, and the reference guide. And in order to let developers have a unified content experience, you should make all those guides link to each other and reuse content from each other and have a consistent user experience. Because if you have the same information written in several places, in one place it misses some note, in some places it's a slightly older version, you can easily create confusion. Okay, so let's start talking about. So I'm not going to talk today about user guides, because the recommended solution for writing user guides is to use DITA, and most of the people already do that. For the topical guides, sometimes people want them to be written by developers, so that's why there is a trend to have them written in Markdown, because developers are very familiar with Markdown. And sometimes it is a good idea, so they can write simple topics in Markdown, because if you only have a title and some paragraphs, there is not a big advantage of using DITA. But at some point, if you want to include more complicated things like a table with a cell that spans multiple columns, or if you want to have lists in a table cell or things like this, you might consider converting the Markdown topic to DITA and then continue writing in DITA. In Oxygen, it's very easy to write a Markdown file and then to convert it to DITA. In version 22, we will also have validation on markdown files that is able to catch some of the style guide issues that may occur when writing markdown. Another way is to write the topical guide from the beginning using DITA. And it has the advantages that I already mentioned. It has built-in support for tables, definition lists, code blocks, and so on. And another interesting thing is that you can reuse parts of the user manual. For example, in GitHub, you can make a repository private. And this comes with some side effects. For example, if the repository already have forks, the forks will still remain public. And in the user guide, you include a note saying that even if you make it private, the forks will remain public. And then you have an API that you can make a repository private programmatically, but you want to include the same note. So if you use DITA for both the user guide and for the developer topical guide, you can reuse that note or even the entire explanation from the user guide. And another interesting feature of DITA is that in XML you can use processing instructions to represent change tracking and inline comments and so on. So it's an easy way to collaborate. Okay, now I will. In these topical guides, usually you have to embed code samples, and sometimes when you are writing a language agnostic API, the API can be used from multiple programming languages, but when a developer reads that topic, they are usually proficient in one of the programming languages. So you don't want to show all the code blocks so that the developer has to scroll through all of them. You want to show them in multiple tabs. So when a user is familiar with, for example, with JavaScript, they switch to the JavaScript tab and they can only see JavaScript code blocks. So here is an example of a topic that uses a tabbed code block. So here is the interface that the technical writer would use to write such a tabbed code block. So the markup is just a small extension of DITA based on output classes. So basically, this is a figure, and there are two code blocks, and they have the output class attribute set to language JavaScript and to language Bash. So here is how you would write the code samples, and when you publish. When you publish this topic to Web Help, it will appear as a tabbed code block. You can also configure the editor to show you tabbed code blocks, but that might be harder to edit. Okay. Let's open the output. So this is how it looks like in the output. So you have two tabs and people can switch between them. Another common practice is to have interactive code blocks. there are some hosting platforms that like CodePen, like JS Fiddle and so on, that that can be used to host code samples, and they offer a kind of a playground so that you offer a working piece of software and developers can change the code a little bit and just play with the API. For example, I don't know, the Chrome on my computer stopped working before this presentation, so I have to copy paste URLs now. But it should be fine. So how this works is that usually developers will create such a code pen playground, and they will share the link with the technical writer, and the technical writer can embed it in the DITA content. So here it's a snake game implemented in CodePen, so I can play snake here. So this is inside the editor, but when I publish, it will also contain be an embedded playground in the documentation. I think I already have something like this here. So this is how it looks like when published. So this is another type of code sample, which is a GIST, and it's hosted by GitHub, the most popular platform for code sharing. Another interesting thing that you can do with DITA is that instead of having your code blocks pasted into the DITA content, you can link them from an external file. And why is that interesting? Is that this external file, you can actually you can run some tests on it to see whether it's really correct. Because at sometimes you can write a code samples, and in three versions, the sample might be outdated and it will not compile anymore. So here I have an example. So this is an example from our web, from our manual. So we have something to add a custom image decorator. So this is the code block that we have. And the problem is that in Java, in order to compile this class, you have to add some imports at the top of the code sample. But these are usually automatically filled in by the development environment, and you usually omit them in code samples for readability reasons. And the alternative way to do this is to use a DITA element which is called the code ref. And basically link the content from another file. The interesting thing is that when you are inserting a code ref, you can say that you want to include, let me switch to text mode and increase the font a bit. You want to include the custom image decorator.java class, but you want only the lines between these tokens, start sample and end sample. And this is how the Java file looks like. So basically it has the imports at the top in order to make it compilable. And then it has the start marker and the end marker, so that only the relevant part will be included in the documentation. And actually this file is part of a valid Java project that I can try to compile. And it's actually compiling with the latest Oxygen SDK, and the file is okay. So now I'm really sure that my code block works, which is a good thing. Okay. Another thing that you have to do in topical guides is to add links to the reference guide. For example, in our we publish a Java doc API for Oxygen, and sometimes we have when we write a tutorial, we say something like, you should use the author external object insertion handler API to control the drag and drop behavior. And usually when you mention such an API class name, you also want to have a link to the Java doc generated documentation. The problem is that we publish this documentation only after the new version is released. But the documentation happens before that. So there are a lot of broken links in the documentation if you use the link directly. What I did here instead is to add an output class. So the name of the Java class is marked with API name, but it has an output class called the Java doc. And now I implemented a CSS for Oxygen XML editor that from the name of the class it composes the name of the URL. And during development, while the API is not publicly released, you can use an alternate style sheet which directs all these links to the staging server where the documentation is published. And the same behavior is implemented also in the as a DITA OT plugin, so it will link correctly in the generated documentation. So now if I click here, it should take me to the website, but since Chrome is not working. Maybe. Let's try to close Firefox and maybe it will ask me to set it as a default. Okay. So now the link should be opened in Firefox. Yes. So this is a nice way for a technical writer to see whether they got the link correctly.
I think this is called sometimes soft linking. So basically you generate the linking not by putting them directly in the code, but by some analysis maybe at the publishing time.
Yeah. So at editing time you just add an output class. And then when you also in the author mode and in the published output, you will get automatically the link. Okay, so now talking about the reference guide, there are some options to write one. So one option is to have it generated either using Open API for REST APIs or Java doc for Java APIs, or I think every programming language has some such a tool that generates reference documentation from code comments. And this approach has some advantages. One of them is always up to date with the code, and another one is that sometimes they have an API playground automatically generated, as I've shown you in the first example here. So here I can actually run make a request to this API from the documentation itself. One thing that surprised me is that I looked at the documentations for services from Google, Microsoft, GitHub, and so on, and I didn't see anything generated from the source code. And my guess is that in the source code, developers may write comments that refer to some internal technologies, and they want to avoid that, because they don't want to make public what their implementation is or something like this. And it's better to have technical writers not aware of any implementation details, because that's how technology doesn't leak outside the company. But that's just my guess. Another alternative is to write the reference guide in DITA or Markdown. And here you also have some advantages. You have a richer content model, because in OpenAPI you can just embed Markdown fragments in descriptions. But in DITA you have a lot of elements. You have notes. You can write equations if that's the case. You can, there are hundreds of elements that you can use. Another advantage is that when you publish such a guide, it has consistent branding with all the other guides that the developer interacts with, like the topical guide, the user guide. Everything has the same branding, the same structure, and so on. So it looks familiar to the user. And also, you can also have an API playground. If when you write the documentation, you use a DITA specialization that preserves a lot of semantic information about the documented API. Okay, so now I'll try to cover some aspects that you encounter when writing documentation for a reference guide. So some of them, if you keep the reference guide and the topical guide completely separated, you have to link to add links between them. So in the reference guide, you have to add a link to a topic that describes that particular object that your API uses. One approach for this is to hard code the URL of where the page is, or of where the topical guide is deployed. But there are a lot of problems. First of all, the topical guide might be made public only after the release, but you want the link to be inserted before that release, and you want to make sure that the link is correct. Another problem is that topical guide might be moved to some other URL at some point. Maybe there is another team that deals with hosting, and they decide to restructure how the documentation is published, or you move to another publishing portal or something, and the URL has to change. So one way we deal with this problem is to have a proxy redirect gate. So from the reference documentation, you link to an URL which redirects to the place where the documentation is actually stored. So, and in our case, we have a help.php script that receives the ID of the page that I want to link to, the name of the product in which this page should appear, and the version of the product. And even if a page is not was removed at some point, or was given a different ID, it will still try to find it in an older version of the product, maybe, or it will try to at least go to the home page of the product so that it doesn't give a 404 error. It tries to get users to the closest possible piece of documentation that is available, and it also logs the error so that we can fix the problem later. This kind of redirect is facilitated by our web help publishing system. Our web help publishing system, when it publishes the HTML pages for the output, it also publishes an XML file which maps the page ID to the actual paths, like topics slash something or tasks slash something. So if I change it from a task to a topic, I don't have to change the URL. The ID will remain the same, and the help .php script will take care to redirect the user to the correct location. Okay. Now coming to REST APIs, more exactly to reference guides for REST APIs, the most popular format to describe such an API is a format called OpenAPI, which is based on JSON, or they also have YAML support. And I have such a sample in Oxygen. So this is how it looks like. So it has a section called paths, and for every URL and for every HTTP method, it has a list of tags, it has a summary and a description. And so this is a JSON file, but in Oxygen we added support for validation of JSON files. And for example, you can write schematron rules to implement custom checks. And you can also use a JSON schema to implement more basic checks, like every method should have a description. And if the method doesn't have a description, there is an error, and Oxygen also offers content completion to insert such a description. So the advantage of using a JSON schema is that it also provides content completion if you are missing something. The advantage of using Schematron is that you can implement more advanced checks, like this description, although it's present, it doesn't start with a capital letter. And this will be, when I generate content, this will be a short description, and short descriptions should always start with capital letter. Also, you can implement checks like the summary, which will become a title, shouldn't end with a period. The description shouldn't be the same as the summary, and so on. Okay, so in such a file, there are only certain keys whose value is related to the generated documentation. Other keys, so for example, the produces key is related to the output format of the response of the server. And this is something that developers care about, and they don't want anyone to touch that, because if you touch that, the application will not work properly. And another feature that is implemented in Oxygen XML editor is that you can use XPath to highlight the elements, to highlight the elements that need to be. Okay. That can be edited for documentation purposes. So now you can see here the tags that you are supposed to attach as a technical writer. And if it's not highlighted, you should leave it as it is. Yeah. And there are some, this is the schematron rules that I shown you. And actually, the rules are pretty simple. You just say that, assert that there is a description, and you provide the custom error message. Okay. Another approach is that instead of editing OpenAPI files and then using standard tools to generate documentation, you can write you can write the reference documentation directly in DITA. To this end, I found on GitHub a DITA specialization that added a new topic type, which is API reference, which is called API reference. And the structure for such a file, let me make it bigger. And also get rid of this. So this file has a title, has a short description as usual, but then it starts to have some custom elements. So for example, this element is called a request, and it has a method, which is get, post, put, or delete, and the resource. You can also add a code sample here, and then you have a response that you can add, and you choose the status code of the response. You also enter a code sample. You also describe the response body here. So this is the name of the parameter, this is the type of the parameter, and this is a description. And the nice thing is that here in the description, you can use any DITA markup. So you can use a note, you can use code PH, you can add images and so on. And this is another response, which is for an error case. And in this case, so for error cases, maybe most of the APIs will return the same response if the user is not authorized to access them. And for this reason, for this thing, you can use a DITA conref, like I did here. You can also insert a new response that is a small fragment that needs to be filled in. Sometimes for some requests, you can also add a request body. And now this topic has also a schematron check saying that a get method cannot have a request body. And you have two options to fix this. You can either remove the body or change the request type to post. So it helps you avoid a certain type of errors. Okay, and this kind of topics can be published to web help to generate a web-based documentation. Yeah, so that's basically the editing interface, and that's the web output. Another option is that you can use the same OpenAPI file, but instead of generating the API using the standard tools, you can generate DITA content and then integrate it in your project. For example, here I created a transformation scenario that generates a folder that includes a map and a lot of other DITA topics, one for each API method. And so if you open that map in the... Okay, so this is the previous example that I started the transformation for. So this is the API method, this is the path, these are the code samples with syntax highlighting, this is the table with the parameters, and so on. Okay, so now this is a map that was prepared by me. And here in the reference guide chapter, I included the generated map, which is read-only now. And it has a chapter which is called endpoints, and then another one which is called resources. For example, it has a data type called task. For review task, it has user data, settings data, and so on. And then the endpoints are like get the content of a file, and it has some parameters with their type, whether they are required or not, and where the parameter is located. So this is DITA content generated from an open API form, open API file. And now the interesting thing is that when I write a tutorial in the topical guide, I can add links to the reference guide. So here I say create a new review task by uploading some files. And if I select this and then say add a cross-reference, and then go in the generated folder and choose this file, here is the reference guide for the reference topic for uploading a review task that documents all the parameters. So I can insert this link, then add a comment. Here I can also add a link to the reference guide. So it's up here, and so on. So, and when I publish, I will get a single documentation that contains both the topical guide and the reference guide with links between them. Another thing that I can do is that I can also inject links in the generated topics by using rel tables. So in DITA, in a DITA map, you can use relationship tables to inject links at publishing time. There is also a way. So let's say the get file contents topic that I have in the reference guide doesn't have a nice short description, because that's what it was in the open API file. And let's say I'm not allowed to touch the open API file. So here the short description is the same as the title. And this is the use case for the DITA conref push mechanism. So I can basically say that this description that I write here should override the short description in the generated file. So I just use push current element, and then I already have the short description selected, and I click OK. And now when I go to the generated documentation, it looks like this. So it has a section of concepts that was written by hand. It has a section of tutorials, which contains my tutorial with links to various topics. And here, for example, you also have a related link which was inserted by the relationship table. And also, if you go to the reference guide, to the get content of a file, here you can see the short description that I wrote in the overriding topic. So that's a powerful way to customize how the API looks like and how to integrate it in a DITA project. So yeah, that's mostly what I had for today. If you have any questions. Yeah.
Can I ask two questions about the OpenAPI to DITA conversion?
Yeah.
First question, which versions of OpenAPI is it supporting currently, the plugin?
I'm not sure.
I don't think there's a massive difference for something like
that. Actually, as far as I know, there are differences for constraints over data types. But usually when you generate documentation, you are mostly interested in descriptions, in textual descriptions. So from this point of view, it may work with any of the versions. So this actually this conversion is implemented as a XSLT script, which can be customized. So in the latest version of Oxygen, we added support to give a JSON file as an input for an XSLT script, and then you can process it as an XML. And from that, you can use the standard tools to generate data.
And is the conversion taking, what content is it taking from the OpenAPI? So it's giving me the method and the endpoint and the descriptions, and is it taking any like parameters and things as well?
Let me show you. So it gets the parameters, and it includes the type, if it's required, and where the parameter is located. And actually, so this converts to standard DITA, but you could convert to a specialized version of DITA, as I've shown you. Actually, that was my plan for this presentation, but it wasn't enough time.
Do we get that specialization as standard in the next Oxygen release? Or?
I'm not sure, but I found it on GitHub. It's called Prisma Doc REST API. So this is a plugin that that can be found on GitHub.
Cool. Thank you.
All right.
Prisma
Doc. Yeah. So it's GitHub Prisma Doc.
Mm-hmm. So I want to make sure I have the same spec exactly. Mm-hmm. So we're testing and documenting against the same source.
Yeah. Other questions?
It's a good use case, as you mentioned, for correlate push, which you don't find, you know, like usually, but this is quite useful.
Yeah, and what I was talking about is that if you have this REST API specialization for DITA, there is a lot of semantical information that it's enough to automatically generate a playground. So you have all the parameters properly tagged, all the data types, and so on. So in theory, you can generate a playground in the documentation. That's some topic to investigate in the future.
Mm-hmm. And I want to have tested code in there as examples, not just any code, but it should be.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, here I just, in this sample, I just tried to compile it, but you can run some real tests on it. Sorry?
Could we get the samples?
I will make them public on GitHub. And so this presentation, I will post it on our website, okay. Like the next week when we go back home. And in the slides, I will add links to the GitHub repository where you can find more the samples that I used in the presentation. Okay. If there are no more questions, thank you.